Sacrament.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Good afternoon, good evening, friends. Buenas tardes, amigos, hermanos, a esta celebración, el inicio de nuestro Triduum Sacro este año. Welcome to this beginning of our sacred Triduum this year. We, of course, are separated by distance, but yet we hold each other close in these days which are the heart of our church's year. We thank you for being part of this celebration today as we share in God's word, as we ponder his word, as we venerate him in the Eucharist. We'll have a holy hour at the end of this broadcast to stay together and pray together in the presence of the Blessed Sacrament. We'll ask the Lord and through the Eucharist to bless our city, to bless our community, to bless all of you as we reach out from this place here on Bryant Avenue to all of you.
Aunque estamos lejos hoy, llevamos a todos en nuestros corazones. Vamos a rezar hoy y también les invitamos a quedar en la Santa Eucarística que tendremos aquí compuesta por una hora después. Rezaremos por nuestra ciudad, por nuestra comunidad y por todos en este tiempo. Gracias por estar con nosotros.
So let us pray. O God, who have called us to participate in a most sacred feast, in which your only begotten Son went about to hand himself over to death, entrusted to the church a sacrifice new for all eternity, the banquet of his love. Grant, we pray, that we may draw from so great a mystery the fullness of charity and of life. Dios nuestro, que nos has reunido para celebrar la fiesta en la cual tu Hijo único, antes de entregarse a la muerte, confió a la Iglesia el sacrificio nuevo y eterno, sacramento de su amor. Concédenos alcanzar por la participación en este sacramento la plenitud del amor y la vida. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall stand at the head of your calendar. You shall reckon it the first month of the year. Tell the whole community of Israel, on the 10th of this month, every one of your families must procure for itself a lamb, one apiece for each household. If a family is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join the nearest household in procuring one and shall share in the lamb in proportion to the number of persons who partake of it. The lamb must be a one-year-old male and without blemish. You may take it from either the sheep or the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month, and then with the whole assembly of Israel present, it shall be slaughtered during the evening twilight. They shall take some of its blood and apply it to the two doorposts and the lintel of every house in which they partake of the lamb. That same night they shall eat its roasted flesh, with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. This You shall eat like those who are in flight. It is the Passover of the Lord. For on this same night I will go through Egypt, striking down every firstborn of the land, both man and beast, and executing judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I, the Lord. But the blood will mark the houses where you are. Seeing the blood, I will pass over you. Thus, when I strike the land of Egypt, no destructive blow will come upon you. This day shall be a memorial feast for you, which all your generations shall celebrate with pilgrimage to the Lord as a perpetual institution. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lectura de la primera carta del apóstol San Pablo a los Corintios. Hermanos, yo recibí del Señor lo mismo que les he transmitido, que el Señor Jesús, la noche en que iba a ser entregado, tomó pan en sus manos y pronunciando la acción de gracias lo partió y dijo: esto es mi cuerpo que se entrega por ustedes. Hagan esto en memoria mía. Lo mismo hizo con el cáliz después de cenar, diciendo: este cáliz es la nueva alianza que se sella con mi sangre. Hagan esto en memoria mía siempre que beban de él. Por eso, cada vez que ustedes comen de este pan y beben de este cáliz, proclaman la muerte del Señor hasta que vuelva. Palabra de Dios.
Te alabamos, Señor.
Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and dry them with a towel around his waist. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Master, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered and said to him, "What I am doing you do not understand now, but you will understand later." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "Unless I wash you, you will have no inheritance with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Master, then not only my feet, but my hands and my head as well." Jesus said to him, "Whoever has bathed has no need except to have his feet washed, for he is clean all over. So you are clean, but not all." For he knew who would betray him. For this reason he said, "Not all of you are clean." So when he had washed their feet and put his garments back on and reclined at table again, he said to them, "Do you realize what I have done for you? You call me teacher and master, and rightly so, for indeed I am. If I, therefore, the master and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash another's feet. I have given you a model to follow, so that as I have done for you, you should also do." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Almost 10 years ago, I visited Poland with a group of pilgrims. We visited the town of Oświęcim, more commonly known by its German name, Auschwitz. Among the things we saw in the extermination camp were Jewish and Catholic religious articles, thimbles that were used as cups and chalices, the lid from a tin can on which the priest prisoners consecrated the Eucharist. When a priest who survived the camp was asked what he used for Mass, he took off his glasses and said, "This is what we use. One lens served as the chalice with a drop of wine, and on the other a piece of bread was placed, which served as the pattern." Theologian and ethicist Stanley Hauerwas writes, "If Christianity makes any sense, it must be because of something to do with eating that meal." Given all that we've been through since, it seems like a long time ago. But it's only been 4 months and one day since we gathered around this altar with Archbishop Hepton to dedicate it, to initiate it for service to our community, for the good of the church, for the good of the world. The introduction to the dedication rite describes the altar as a table of sacrifice, the place of the Paschal banquet, and as a sign of Christ himself, all familiar references. But before those descriptions is this compelling paragraph: "The Christian is also a spiritual altar. Since Christ is the true altar, it says, his disciples are also spiritual altars on which the sacrifice of a holy life is offered to God. St. Gregory the Great writes, what is God's altar if not the souls of those who lead good lives? Rightly, then, the heart of the just is said to be the altar of God. The altar in our sanctuary is but a reminder for us to be living, breathing, walking, talking altars wherever we are, our very bodies being the means by which sacrifice and praise is continually offered to God. You'll recall that at the dedication, the Archbishop anointed the altar, covered it actually with the oil of chrism. At the end of the Mass, he invited us to come up and smell the altar and experience that earthy fragrance of chrism. Given all that we've been through since, it seems like a long time ago, but we too were once anointed with chrism at our baptism, initiated for service to our community, for the good of the church, for the good of the world. While we may not still smell that fragrant aroma on us, it's there. Although we're not gathered today here in the same place at this altar, wherever you are right now, there's an altar. That altar, of course, is you. So if Christianity makes any sense, it must be because of something to do with what happens, not only at this altar, but at that altar, the altar that is you, the sacrifice, the celebration, the dying and rising, the feeding, the foot washing. So that as I have done for you, you also should do. Hace casi 10 años visité Polonia con un grupo de peregrinos. Visitamos la ciudad de Oświęcim, más conocida por su nombre alemán Auschwitz. Entre las cosas que vimos en el campo de exterminio fueron artículos religiosos judíos católicos, dedales que se utilizaban como copas y cálices, la tapa de una lata en la que los sacerdotes prisioneros consagraban la Eucaristía. Cuando se le preguntó a un sacerdote que sobrevivió al campamento que usaba para la misa, se quitó las gafas y dijo, esto es lo que usamos. Una lente servía como cáliz con una gota de vino y en la otra se colocaba un pedazo de pan que servía como patén. El teólogo y ético Stanley Hauerwas escribe, si el cristianismo tiene algún sentido, debe ser por algo que tenga que ver con comer esa comida. tomando en cuenta todo lo que hemos pasado en estas semanas, parece que hace mucho tiempo reunimos alrededor de este altar con el arzobispo su agenda para dedicarlo. En realidad, era solamente hace 4 meses y un día cuando reunimos para iniciarlo para el servicio a nuestra comunidad, por el bien de la iglesia, por el bien del mundo. La introducción al rito de dedicación describe al altar como una mesa de sacrificio, el lugar del banquete pascual, como signo de Cristo mismo. Todos son referencias familiares. Pero antes de esas descripciones hay un párrafo importante. El cristiano también es un altar espiritual. Puesto que Cristo es el verdadero altar, dice, sus discípulos son también altares espirituales, en los que se ofrece a Dios el sacrificio de una vida santa. San Gregorio Magno escribe: ¿qué es el altar de Dios sino las almas de los que llevan buenas vidas? Con razón, entonces, se dice que el corazón de los justos es el altar de Dios. El altar de nuestro santuario no es más que un recordatorio para que nosotros seamos altares vivos, donde quiera que estemos respirando, caminando, hablando. Que nuestros propios cuerpos sean los medios por los cuales el sacrificio y la alabanza se ofrece continuamente a Dios. Recordarán que en la dedicatoria del arzobispo ungió el altar, lo cubrió en su totalidad con el aceite de Cristo. Al final de la misma nos invitó a subir y oler el altar y experimentar esa fragancia terrosa del Cristo. Tomando en cuenta todo lo que hemos pasado desde entonces, y también parece hace mucho tiempo, nosotros fuimos ungidos con el crisma en nuestro bautismo, iniciados para servir a nuestra comunidad por el bien de la iglesia, por el bien del mundo. Aunque todavía no llevemos ese aroma fragrante, llevamos su marca. Aunque hoy no estamos reunidos aquí en el mismo lugar, en este altar, donde quiera que estés ahora, hay un altar. Ese altar, por supuesto, eres tú. Si el cristianismo tiene algún sentido, debe ser por algo que ver con lo que sucede no solo en este altar, sino en sus altares, en ustedes, el sacrificio, la celebración, la muerte y el levantamiento, la alimentación, el lavado de pies. Para que lo que yo he hecho con ustedes, también ustedes lo hagan. Bring the prayers of this day, las oraciones del día, las oraciones del mundo, the prayers of the world, before our loving God.
Por la Iglesia, mientras que celebramos este Triduo Santo y el misterio pascual de la pasión, muerte y resurrección de Jesús, que crezcamos fuertemente en fe y confianza en Dios.
For God's Church, as we celebrate this holy Triduum and the Paschal mystery of Jesus' passion, death, and resurrection, may we grow strong in our faith and confident in God's promise that we always be one in Christ. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Por los líderes cívicos en todo el mundo, que estén iluminados por la sabiduría del Espíritu Santo, a buscar paz, justicia e igualdad para todos.
For civic leaders throughout the world, may they always be enlightened by the wisdom of the Holy Spirit to seek peace, justice, and equality for all. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Por todos que sienten aislados, deprimidos y con temor durante este tiempo de aislación, que reconozcamos la gracia preciosa y amor abundante de Dios en nuestras vidas y en toda la creación.
For all who are feeling lonely, depressed, and fearful during this time of isolation, may we recognize the precious and boundless gift of God's grace and love within each of our lives and in all of creation. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Por todos que están enfermos con el coronavirus y por los médicos, enfermeras, científicos de investigación y todos los trabajadores en el sector de salud y los que les apoyen en su compromiso a salvar vidas.
For all who are sick with the coronavirus, and for physicians, nurses, research scientists, all healthcare workers, and for all who support them in their commitment to save lives, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Por la misericordia de Dios para los feligreses quienes están enfermos o sufriendo y necesitan nuestras oraciones.
For God's mercy and love on our parishioners who are sick and suffering and in need of our healing prayers, especially for Karen Rito, Placido Delgado, and Jean Flynn. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
En agradecimiento por las vidas de nuestros seres queridos difuntos, que sus vidas animen nuestra fidelidad hasta el día cuando nosotros también alcancemos la vida eterna.
In thanksgiving for the lives of our departed brothers and sisters, may their lives encourage our faithfulness until the day when we too are raised up to the fullness of eternal life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We join these prayers to the great prayer of Jesus as we pray together. Juntos oremos. Padre,
Padre nuestro, que estás en el cielo. Santificado sea tu nombre,
thy kingdom come,
thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Our prayer today is joined, of course, with the prayer of Christians throughout the world, and indeed the whole communion of saints. Let's call upon the saints to be with us, to surround all of us, to surround our troubled and sick world in these days.
Lord, have mercy. Thank you. John Paul II, Peter Claver, Martin de Porres, all you holy men and women, pray for us.
Sure.